observable part. This is the incredible amount of number of stars and planets that in space. And down to the atom and subatomic, the particle scientists are still discovering. They have not finished discovering what else, or more of the subatomic particles. And if you think about the sort of beauty in nature, the order in which the animals and plants relate to one another, every snowflake is different. There's different seasons, the beauty that God has created for this earth. The different plants and flowers, the birds, the fish, the animals, and the crowning creation, man and woman. You and I are the crowning creation of what the world with the Father has created. So comes the question, where do I come from? Well, you come from God, Father, who has chosen you. Even before the world was founded, that was what was written in Ephesians chapter 1. And also when the world was founded, there was a great joy in heaven. In Job chapter 8, verse 7, it says, when God asks in verse 4, he asks Job, where were you when I laid the foundation of the earth? Tell me if you have understanding. When the morning stars sang together and all the sons of God shouted for joy, it was a great celebration. When the earth was established, when the first humans were created by God. So it was not God's intent to have sorrow, to have pain, to have death in the world that was made. But verse 3 gives a hint that something happened. Something happened. When Jesus says that the light, in verse 5, it says the light shines in the darkness. And the darkness has not overcome it. There was darkness. There was darkness that crept in. And this darkness is not just ignorance of God, it's a form of rebellion. A rebellion against the knowledge and the rule of God in the creation that God has made. And that's why the word has to come into this darkness as the light to bring again the knowledge of the love of God back to the world that has separated and disconnected themselves from the love of the Father. See, God, remember the joy that they have when the world was first established. And he's not willing to let the world be destroyed without coming to rescue us. And that was what drives him, his love for us. And so the second question, why am I here for? Because we live in, because unless you know Jesus, who is the light of the world, you always live in that darkness. You never could see and know him. There was a story in Hyde Park when there was a, people sat in a console box, and there was a Christian preaching about, about Jesus, and the hackers, and say, where is God? I can't see him. What are you talking about? And so there's this thing going on. And suddenly a man with dark glasses and a white snake shouted and said, hey, you guys talk about rainbows. I can't see any. You see, you're blind, you're able to understand. And so the light came into the darkness, and the darkness cannot understand it or cannot overcome it. And so if you were to come to know Jesus, it's because God has opened your eyes to let you see him for the first time. But he gives you an invitation to accept him. That's the one step that you need to do. When Jesus came into the world, he took on human flesh. He has two natures from then on. A divine nature, which never left him, but also a human nature. And he took on a human body. Even today, Jesus does have a human body. Philip Yancey, in his book, Jesus I Never Knew, he understood a little bit about what it means to have this incarnation. He said, I own a marine aquarium. And I kept some of the fishes there. But he said, it's not easy to keep that aquarium. I have to make sure that the nitrate level, the vitamins are all there. The water has to be filtered properly. And he said, I would have thought my fish were very grateful to see me caring for that and so on. But he said, every time when my shadow looped over the tank, all the fish would die from color, either behind the shells or the rocks. They only show one emotion, and that's fear. He said, oh, I'll open the lid and feed the fish three times a day. But they view me with fear. I was too large for them, and my actions cannot be understood. He said, to change their perception, I begin to understand that I have to come like a fish, to dwell among them, to show them that I can, to speak in the language they can understand. So Jesus came to reveal to us the love of the Father by becoming one of us. Jesus also lived a life that's perfect, so that he can tell you and me that we can live that life when we allow his life to come into our life. And thirdly, more importantly, he has become that sacrifice for us so that we can be saved from our sins. There must be a penalty to pay for the wrong things that we have done before God can give us that forgiveness. Because the judgment, the justice of God demand the penalty. So the purpose in life is, what is the purpose in our life? Well, if you're not a believer, if you do not know your purpose, I mean, some people's purpose is like, eat, drink, and be merry, because tomorrow we die. But there's a more, a deeper purpose than that. If you look at Acts chapter 17, verses 26 to 27. Well, let's read together. Say what it was. Let's read out. And he made. Like the physical building, you start with bricks, and as you start to build taller and taller, the number of bricks per level start to, if you build using Lego bricks, you cannot build with the same number of bricks because eventually, you know, a little disturbance will cause whole tower blocks to fall off. But if we build our lives based on Jesus, receiving grace upon grace, you start with a bit of grace in your life. Grace is what you don't expect from God, what is you don't deserve. It's a favor from God. It's an act of God's kindness to you. Once you get that benefit of kindness in your life, you exercise on it. God says, I give you more grace in other areas, so that you begin to thrive building grace on grace. You have more grace over your life than ever before. So what I'm going to say is that you may have the grace to serve. And once you start to serve people, God will give you more grace to be able to serve even more. God will give you the grace you want to be generous. And when you become generous, God will also give you more grace to bless others in a similar way. So when you realize that God has given you grace in your employment, in your business, in your family, in your friends, when you acknowledge that these are the grace that God gives you, sometimes you look back, where are you today? It's by the grace of God. Today I just had a testimony of Stephen. They say Inene was killed by a car that just drove past him as he was trying to cross a pedestrian crossing. He survived today by the grace of God. Sometimes I acknowledge that God gives us that grace so that we can build on more grace. And when you receive more and more grace, you become more and more like Jesus. But we have to acknowledge His grace that sustains us in the first place. It is not fulfilling this world, fulfilling the law as well. God, thank you that you gave me the strength. Thank you, you gave me the opportunity. Thank you, you gave me that. Whatever situation that you have given me so that I can live this life today, I want to invest that back to glorify you. When you do that, God will give you more grace. But sometimes grace is not just given to us to bless us materially or health-wise. Sometimes grace is there to see us through a difficult patch. The problem may not go away, but God's grace is enough to see through. Sometimes we find that, why am I down to the wrong deal in life? But the word of God says that my grace is sufficient for you, for my power is made perfect in your weakness. Some of you know that my wife went through chemo for 6 months, from last year, September until this year, March. And some of you may realize that, how difficult chemo is. And my wife looked back at me, when I look back those 6 months, I'm surprised that I survived those 6 months without feeling down or depressed or angry. But when I look back those 6 months, when she's going through chemo, she says it's a bit like hell to me. She wondered how she would survive it. Because every 2 weeks you have to go to the chemo unit and they will trip. You know, highly toxic. On the back they say highly toxic. And drip into tube that is implanted in her for 6 months. It was threaded from the arm right to her heart. And when it's over, she said 2.5 days to carry another bottle on her side, linked to that tube. But the chemo is stripped for another 2 days. And so you have to suffer the side effect for 1 week. And just when you're about to recover, then you go for another dose. And you do that every 2 weeks. But she said it is the grace of God. She stood on God's promise that do not be anxious for tomorrow. Sufficient is the evil today. She stood on the promise of God. She said, my life is in the hands of God. Whether I die, for me to live is Christ, to die is gain. That is the grace of God. To overcome the fear of death, to overcome the fear of pain and side effects. And the sheer 6 months is a long time, right? Even 4 days of flu is like quite a lot to take. So that's the second question, right? What is your purpose in life? It's to live on the grace of God as a Christian. But if you're not a Christian, You need to see God and find Him. And thirdly, the final question, where am I going? Well, Jesus said, there are many rooms in my Father's house, and I'll go and prepare a place for you. Eventually, we will die. And for those who believe in Jesus, the Lord will bring you to spend an eternity with Him, where there's a restoration of the joy and the gladness when the creation was first made in the first place. And just to give you that assurance, the Holy Spirit lives in us. To give us that assurance that Jesus said, I will surely take you back. Don't worry. Whatever affects you in this life, I will make sure that you will go back safely home. So as we celebrate Christmas, as we open up our questions, let us have some time to reflect over these very important existential questions. Where did I come from? What am I doing here in this earth? And where am I going? So even as you open every gift that you receive over Christmas, spend time to thank Jesus for His unspeakable gift, His amazing love, giving us unrelenting hope, incredible salvation, and unending love for the true meaning, and undiminishing hope and everlasting joy. Let's pray.
Today, you feel that you need that touch of grace from God. I just
of the anointing will come forward so that our ministry team can pray for you and bless you as we sing the last song. Let's all stand.